Steve Allen's Music Room, where the music is the start of something big. Visiting Steve in the Music Room, recording star Rosemary Clooney, jazz great saxophonist Red Holloway, pianist and concert artist James Raphael, Grammy Award-winning singer Lou Rawls, Terry Gibbs and his All-Star Orchestra, and of course, Steve Allen.
Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Well, because Bill Maher, our young whippersnapper sidekick and announcer, did such an invigorating, stimulating warm-up, we have a wild crowd here. And really, it's going to be sort of a waste, Bill, because, as you know, the name of the show is Music Room. We don't plan to do any comedy. Oh, I might go or something of that sort, just for old time's sake. But no actual comedy. How are you this evening?
I'm great. This is a hot crowd, don't you think?
Yeah, but we'll certainly take care of that in no time.
A hot house.
Yes.
They're vegetables. No.
It's great, and it must be quite a thing to hear your own theme song play there every night.
You know, the fact it almost escaped my attention. If you write a song that is successful, thanks to the universe for that, then suddenly after about the ninth year of hearing it, it's almost as if somebody else wrote it.
Yeah?
True. Mm-hmm.
People who have written successes, I was reading the Alan J. Lerner book. Did you ever?
One of the great lyricists, Alan J. Lerner.
Talk about money. When those guys wrote My Fair Lady, he tells the story in the book, they went over to London one day for lunch. That's how well they were doing. They could just fly to London for lunch.
Yeah.
And they have lunch and they decide they're going to go buy Rolls Royces, each one of them.
Uh-huh.
They get to the Rolls Royce joint and they each pick out a silver Rolls, and Fritz Lowe takes out his checkbook and Lerner says to him, no, you got lunch, let me get this.
That's a true story.
Doing well.
That is a true story. I must explain, however, to the audience, you're supposed to laugh at the jokes and applaud for the guests. You seem to have it just the other way around, but that's all right.
That's my fault. I didn't tell them.
You just told it so great they had to applaud. That's all.
But now you have written 4,000 something songs, and yet
reading that, yeah.
Your bio says you're a musical illiterate, if I may.
Well, my bio's a dirty liar. I am a musical illiterate. Illiterate means
you can't read.
One cannot read, and I cannot read one. No, I cannot read music. Sometimes people think, well, if you can't read it, how come you can compose all that stuff?
If you can't read it, how can you compose all that
stuff? Oh, you're one of those people? Another announcer, please. The question is a fair one.
Yeah. You don't have an answer now.
Yourself. The thing is that composing has really nothing to do. It has an only tertiary connection.
Uh-huh. Well, why don't you show us what you mean by that? Tertiary connection.
In the interstices. No, seriously.
Can you show us what that?
Not while I'm eating. No, I can't. But you compose in your head. And after that, it wouldn't matter if you whistled it to an Armenian fellow in the fields or whatever. And as it happens, I just put my music into tape recorders, and then someone who cannot compose a note writes it on paper for me.
That Armenian guy in the field.
No, it's a figure of speech. I figured I'd make a speech. But what can I do? What can I do for you?
Well, I'd like to see you write a song.
Well, I've already written one. I'm not going to stand here now because the people would get a little tiresome. It would be tiresome for them to watch it. Which one do we have up tonight, Terry? I honestly forget. This is a song that I actually wrote from the score of a Broadway musical called Sophie, about the life of Sophie Tucker. And in the song, in the show, all the way through the first act, people tell her to get out of show business. She's overweight, she's not very pretty, and her voice is strange. And finally, she seriously has enough of this, and she says, wait a minute, I'll show them all. And that is the name of this song. Unfortunately, you're only going to hear the music to it, but better that than nothing, right? And it goes like this. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Mellow, smooth, velvety. Too close? No, seriously, that may sound like the start of a commercial for processed cheese, but those are just a few of the words commonly used to describe the voice of Lou Rawls. His is a really unmistakable sound. It's the sound of blues, gospel, big band. And as the title song of one of his new albums says, when you hear Lou, you've heard it all. So let's hear it all right now for Mr. Lou Rawls.
As long as you live, someone who loves you tender like I do. You'll never find, no matter where you search, someone who cares about you the way I do. Take the end of all time, someone to understand you like I do. And you'll never find the rhythm, the rhyme, all of the magic we shared, just us two.
Beautiful. Nice job.
How you doing?
Good.
All right.
That is an unmistakable sound. We were mentioning and introducing you, Lou, in case you couldn't hear us backstage, that you've done gospel and blues and rhythm and blues, big band. Is there any particular kind of music that brings you the most joy?
Well, yeah, it all brings me joy, but I think gospel music is really, I guess you'd say, my real...
That's a little more emotion, you think?
Yeah, it has much more emotion.
Yeah.
You know, and if you get, if you've been in it like I was, you know, I started out about 7 years old in the junior choir with the late Sam Cooke and group now called the Flamingos. Some of them are still around, but we started out singing together.
Oh, yeah.
We had, you know, we were the little corner doo-wop groups, you know.
Good,
but that music was, I guess you'd say that was my, cut my teeth on that, more or less.
Well, then you were sort of starting to work at about the same time that you were forming, developing your own musical influences, or were there any people that you listened to but did not work with who sort of helped to form you?
Oh, sure, man, there was, see, we had a theater in Chicago called the Regal Theater.
Uh-huh.
They used to have live stage shows, you know. We would go there on weekends and see people like Joe Williams, Billy Eckstein.
Yeah. In the South Side?
Yeah. And Al Hibbler, people like that, because, you know, they had the rich voices, and so consequently I could relate to them.
Oh, right.
And, of course, when I got into the business and I met Joe Williams and Billy Eckstein and Al Hibbler, I mean, I was blown away, but they didn't know it, you know. Like, you know, it's one of those kind of things you don't really want to show how much you, you know, are involved and how much you care. But...
You seem... very authoritative and are when you work. You're much in command. Have you ever had the sense of being in awe of other performers?
Yes, yeah, but they didn't know it. No, because see, you know, it's like, you want to know something? Today, when we were rehearsing, you know, and I was rehearsing with Rosemary Clooney, man, I went outside and fell apart. But I couldn't do it in here because I want everybody to see it, you know.
Yeah,
I went outside and said, yeah.
We won't tell. We won't tell. You know, it's remarkable how rarely we can remember the precise moment that we first became aware of people who in time were important in our lives. Over the years, while chatting with people in studio audiences, I've often asked husbands or wives the simple question, do you remember exactly how the two of you first met? In most cases, believe it or not, they do not. They may recall they were both going to the same college or, you know, lived in St. Louis or whatever, but the actual moment of meeting is usually lost to recollection. And consequently, it's odd, I guess, that I do recall the very first time I ever even heard of Rosemary Clooney. The year was 1940. I was a freshman at Drake University in Des Moines, Iowa, and at the time I occupied most of my weekends by playing the piano in various local dance bands. And I was in some distinguished sort of fancy stuffy, the downtown club one evening, very comfortable establishment. And there was about a 25-minute break between dance sets, and I was seated alone on a large overstuffed sofa just relaxing when my attention was suddenly drawn to some marvelous big band music coming from a nearby radio. A moment later, I heard a beautiful voice. Never heard it before. I identified the moment thereafter as that of Rosemary Clooney. And the next song was something that was sung by Rosemary and her sister, Betty. They were known as the Clooney sisters, not too surprisingly. And nothing very interesting about that fact either, except that the unmistakable, clear, emotional sound of Rosemary's voice made such a strong impression on me that I remember it to this day. And I'm really honored that she's here with us today. Let's welcome to our music room a major star of the world of popular music. Lou Rawls was just saying how much in awe he is of her. We all are. The great Rosemary Clooney.
Move over, sun, and give me some sky. I got me some wings, I'm eager to try. I may be unknown, but wait till I've flown. You're gonna hear from me. Make me some room, you people up there. On top of the world, I'll meet you, I swear. Remember my name, I'm staking my claim. You're gonna hear from me. Fortune smiled on the road before me. I'm fortune's child. Listen, world, you can't ignore me. I've got a song that longs to be played. Raise up my flag, begin my parade. Then start the world over, start coming up clover. That's how it's gonna be, you see. You're smiled on the road before me. I'm fortune's child. Listen, world. Coming up clover, that's how it's gonna be, you see. Full of you. You used to be too wise. Hey there, you on that high flying cloud. Though he won't throw a crumb to you, you think someday he'll come to you. You had better forget him. Him with his nose in the air. He has you dancing on a string. Break it and he won't care. Won't you take this advice? I hand you like a mother. Or are you not seeing things too clear? Are you too much in love? Is it all going in one ear and out the other?
Good stuff. Yeah, is that a nice sound?
It's a nice sound. A really nice sound. Thank you.
Folks, we were going to have her do a third number, but you applauded too long and cut into her time. Anyway, now that's more than applause. That's an ovation. Very well deserved, too.
Oh, nice, too.
May we, now that you're comfortable, want a little orange juice or anything like that?
No, thanks.
Okay,
thanks.
May we try a little word association test? I will say something like Albee Theater in Cincinnati. What do you think of?
Oh, that's where I used to go and hear the bands when I was going to school.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes when I went to school.
Is the story true that your sister Betty, while she was still in high school, actually at one point did not go to school for, was it 3 months, because she preferred to go to the Albee Theater to see the big bands play?
Yes, and you know the worst part of it is she didn't even tell me, so I couldn't cover for her.
Uh-huh.
Now, I'm not saying that that's a very good thing to do,
no.
You know, because
I'm now
a grandmother, and we have to think about those things. As
you're
as
a grandmother.
I am. I have three grandchildren.
Grandchildren.
Three, yes. that's why I
well,
am.
That's good, yeah.
Well, listen.
I was running over a song earlier today, and I'd like to run over it again, if I may, to see if you remember. remember the words to it. It was one of the first things I ever heard you sing. I still think it's a lovely song, although you became enormously successful. The song did not, but it's a pretty thing. It was written, the lyric anyway, by a friend named Floyd Huddleston. It's called You Started Something. Remember that?
With Tony Pastor, I recorded that.
Yeah, let me see.
You were just passing by, but you started something. I may never know why, but you started something. With your glance, a new romance was in the making. Just like the sun starts the flowers to waking. Didn't know I remembered that. I knew all about love. I said, this can't happen. But then you came along and caught my heart napping. Now each hour of each new day will always be spring, 'cause you really started something.
It's a nice song, isn't it?
In the 1950s, you did a number of motion picture musicals. The Stars Are Singing, Here Come the Girls, which you worked with Bing Crosby. I would imagine that for the average singer, just the idea of working with Bing Crosby, singing with him, must be somehow the supreme achievement. Do you think so?
I do think so. You were talking about...
people in awe.
You know, yes, I never got over really working with him.
I would imagine.
Except that he was never comfortable with any kind of show of that kind of nervousness or being in awe of himself.
Uh-huh.
So that you had to kind of pretend, but every now and then you'd catch an angle of a hat or the pipe,
uh-huh,
and suddenly you're just, you know, caught up short. Yeah. Hey, I'm working with Bing Crosby here.
Like I was this afternoon.
With what?
With you.
Oh, come on, don't you say that?
Oh, why not? It's true. Yeah.
But you know, Lou, Rosie Thank did Bing's you. First television special. That was with Frank Sinatra, too, wasn't it?
Boy.
Pretty fast company.
I tell you.
Yeah.
And Louis Armstrong as well.
Ah,
yep.
I'd forgotten that.
Yep.
There was a 12-minute medley, one of the first
I think it was one of those, one of the first of that kind.
Yeah.
We did all kinds of songs. And I think that that Frank showed up for one rehearsal that we were sure of.
Uh-huh.
Of course, Bing woodshed it all the time, so I knew that I had to work at home to learn my part, too.
That's interesting. Now, let's go over that point again, because a lot of kids who are wanting to get into music think they can kind of phone it in, you know, what you might call the Dean Martin approach to show business. Only Dean can get away with
it's
that.
True. It's true. That
Because he's so adorable that he gets away with it. But Bing Crosby, maybe the king of them all, worked all the time.
All the time. He would rehearse at home so much so that the first time we rehearsed together, he was clean. He was off the paper. He knew everything.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, it paid off for him.
Yeah.
We happen to have, our research people have dug up a clip of that old show from 1957.
No. Really?
And we're going to run it for all of our dining dancing pleasures right now. Yeah.
Oh,
Frank,
there she
Rosie
is.
And Bing.
Wonderful. Marvelous. That you should care. For me,
I'm jealous of the moon that shines above. I'm jealous of Swanky Frankie too. But I don't suppose that's any kind of news. Made that fit?
Yes, you did.
To you, I got rhythm.
Got it.
I got music.
Oh.
I got your girl. Who could ask for anything more? My mama done told me.
Why? I'm that geese, didn't tell you.
When I was a knee pant.
There's another song I'd love to do with you. I know it's one of your favorites. I think it's a favorite song of almost everybody who knows good American music and has a special sensitivity to it. Written by James Van Heusen, words by Johnny Burke. Would you like to do a chorus of But Beautiful?
I would love it.
All right. My honor to work over here at this thing.
Love is funny, or it's sad. or it's quiet, or it's mad. It's a good thing, or it's bad. But beautiful, beautiful to take a chance. And if you fall, you fall. And I'm thinking I wouldn't mind at all. Love is tearful, or it's gay. It's a problem, or it's play. It's a heartache either way. But beautiful, and I'm thinking if you were mine, I'd never let you go. And that would be but beautiful.
Just occurred to me, I forgive me for not, nobody can know everything. I don't know, have you guys ever worked together before today, officially?
No.
Well, we have a little
TV. Why do you
TV
think first. I went crazy outside?
I tell you, it's a joy for me, let me tell you.
Oh, hey.
Oh, man.
Listen, well, when I first
you're
met
two
your
of
brother
the best.
In Cincinnati, I said, are you Rosemary Clooney's brother?
My little brother, Nicky, yes.
I think we have Terry and the band set up there to give you some help. I understand you're going to do some old standards for us,
we
right?
We are. We're going to do... This is a revenge medley.
Revenge?
You bet.
Rosie and Lou.
I cried for you. Now it's your turn to cry over me. Every single road has a turning, baby. That's one thing I'm sure you're learning. I used to be. Now I found two eyes that were a little bit bluer. I found me a little heart that was just a little bit truer. I cried for you, ooh-wee, baby. But now it's your turn to cry over me.
Who's sorry now? Who's sorry now for the heartache you brought to me? I bet you're just as sorry as you can be. Who's sad and blue and crying, crying too? Just like I cried. True blue friend.
Eve. Goody, goody. Met someone and now you know how it feels. Well,
you made her your heart too.
Well,
just as I gave mine to you. And she's walking in little pieces. Now, how do you do?
Well, you're sitting alone just crying the blues all day, all night too, baby. So you think goody, goody for me.
Goody, goody for me. And
I hope you're satisfied. Said, I hope you're satisfied. Said, I hope you're still satisfied. I hope you're satisfied too.
You rascal.
What can I tell you, baby? I'm satisfied too.
You give people good stuff and they really appreciate it,
oh,
you know?
Wow.
You know, this series may bring back good songs.
Yeah. That's great.
As long as we get people like you to keep putting them on the counter. Well, we have another interesting gentleman. Mm-hmm. You don't hear too often about hit records that are purely in the jazz category. Thank goodness it does happen from time to time, but it's not a very common thing, as I say. Our next guest has been traveling the highways and byways of jazz for over 40 years. His unique saxophone sound has backed such artists as Billie Holiday, bluesmaster B.B. King, a lot of other well-known performers. I'm talking about Red Holloway. And Red is now what promoters and producers call a must-booking at jazz festivals all over the world. And his marvelous melody, No Tears Over You, is a hit in the jazz field, and that's good news for jazz and for Red and for all of us. Here it is. No Tears Over You is played by the composer, Mr. Red Holloway.
Thank you.
Terry Gibbs, why don't we put you to work?
Really? Hey.
Should we do that? Since doing a lot of great music on today's show, and we were talking earlier about a number of these shows. We've mentioned George Gershwin. When you did the that special back in the 50s with Bing and Frank, of course there was George Gershwin music inevitably, and we're going to show you two different faces of George Gershwin. First of all, we'll start out with a Gershwin jazz classic. It's interesting that there are many composers who are terrific, but whose works are rarely played by jazz people. We were discussing this the other night, Burt Bacharach, on one of the shows of our series, one of the greatest composers of the century, but there's very little jazz playing of his melodies. Gershwin, on the other hand, has been a jazz favorite for about 50, 60 years now. So here is one of the classics of Gershwin's creation, I Got Rhythm. I'm gonna jump over there and give Terry a little bit of a hand. And you'll have to, by the way, pay very careful attention, because Terry Gibbs can play 79 notes per measure with his vibes, but you would have to have the auditory sensitivity of a hummingbird or a shrew to really appreciate that. So take my word for it. It's just a blur. And then, as if that isn't enough, he's going to come over to my instrument and play an interminable solo with just two fingers, ladies and gentlemen. Game trooper that he is. He can play more notes with just two fingers than the average piano player can with three fingers. Anyway, here is Terry Gibbs to do I Got Rhythm. There you go. Thank you.
Yeah. Terry Gibbs, King of the Vibes, and Terry's very happy because his lovely wife, Queen of the Vibes, is sitting right over there this evening. And his little son, Prince of the Vibes, is sound asleep upstairs in the dressing room. Now, that's the jazzy side of George Gershwin. We have next the more formal Gershwin. He was the first popular American composer to significantly incorporate the jazz idiom into a serious symphonic framework. His Rhapsody in Blue will live on, I suppose, forever, concert halls. And here to play it for us this evening, we have a very gifted young gentleman I met just recently here in town. His name is James Raphael. He's a brilliant young American pianist who was a protege and student of the great Otto Rubinstein. And he now performs in concert halls all over the world. Here is James Raphael with his interpretation of George Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. James. Wonderful. Brilliant. Sit right down there. Yeah. Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah. James, how many years have you been playing?
Oh, about 20 years.
It shows.
Yes.
Remember the old joke, stop a guy on the corner, how do I get to Carnegie Hall? Practice.
Practice.
Before I forget, why is my index finger up in the air? Anyway, I neglected earlier to mention that among Rosemary Clooney's many fine albums is this one, titled Rosemary Clooney, Rosie Sings, Bing. And it has But Beautiful and Pennies from Heaven, a lot of great old Bing Crosby songs. Glad we remembered that.
Thank you.
And we've mentioned your album, right, and your hit single.
That's correct.
And that leaves time enough for one more song by Lou Rawls. Lou, what would you like to do for us?
I want to do a song that went up in space.
Really?
Yeah. The first brother in space took it up in space with him.
Did he really?
Yeah, he did.
That's great.
He took it. He was downtown the other day, and my mother saw him. She said, did you take my son up in space?
What's the name of the song?
Wind Beneath My Wings.
Wind Beneath My Wings. Yeah. Good thing to have in space, although there's no wind up there. A little solar wind is all we can have.
Yeah.
Be back in a minute.
All right, sweetheart.
Okay, fine. See you in a minute.
Lou Rawls with Terry Gibbs in the back.
It starts off kind of weird, but we decided to work it this way. So, you know, it must be cold standing in my shadow, never having the sunlight on your face. Oh, but you're content to let me shine while you walk a few steps behind. Now, I'm the one that gets all the glory, while you're the one that stands behind me with all that strength. Hey, just a face without a name. But I've never once heard you complain. Did you ever know that you are my hero? Everything I would like to be. I can fly higher than an eagle because you are the wind beneath my wings. It might have appeared to go unnoticed, but I've got it right here in my heart. I want you to know that I know the truth. I would be nothing without you.
Music Room. Beautiful, Lou. Good song. James Redfield, we thank you so much for your inspiring performance tonight. And the same goes for Red Holloway. Red, continued good luck with that marvelous recording. Lou Rawls, Rosemary Clooney, Bill Maher, let this be a lesson to you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Let it be a lesson to all of us. Bye-bye from the Music Room. Thank you.